In this video, we quickly derive a formula for the gravitational potential energy of a rigid body, and then we apply the formula to an example. So we start by looking at a rigid body, and any rigid body can be broken into point masses as we've shown in the diagram. So that's m1, m2, m3, all the way to some mn, where n is the total number of particles that we broke it into. In addition, we've shown the center of mass position vector pointing from the origin to the center of mass of the rigid body. And the formula for the center of mass position vector is given by 1 over the total mass of the object times the sum of each mass multiplying each position vector for those masses, so the sum of mi times ri. And I'll post a link to the video where I derived that. So that's a vector equation, and any vector equation can be broken down into its components. So I could write down the x coordinate of the center of mass as 1 over the total mass times the sum of mi times the x coordinate of the ith mass. And the y center of mass coordinate is similar, 1 over the total mass times the sum of each mi multiplied by its y coordinate. Now that second one is the one that we want because we're looking for gravitational potential energy, and that depends on the y coordinate, not the x coordinate. So to find the total gravitational potential energy of this rigid body, we just write down the potential energy of every single point mass that it's made of, and each one of those point masses contributes an mgy, so I'm going to sum the MIGYI terms, and I'm adding together the potential energy of every single point mass the rigid body is made of. Next, I can factor out the G because that's a constant common to every term in that sum, and I end up with G times the sum of MI times its Y coordinate YI. Now I recognize that expression from the center of mass Y coordinate. The sum of MI times YI is equal to M multiplying the y center of mass coordinate. And to write things in a little more familiar order, I have capital M, G, y center of mass, and we've got our formula for the gravitational potential energy of a rigid body. So it's important to see the physical interpretation here. We're taking the total mass of the object, multiplying by G, and then multiplying by the y center of mass coordinate. So what we're doing is pretending the entire object has its mass concentrated at the center of mass, and then we're finding the gravitational potential energy of that point mass. So let's apply our new formula for gravitational potential energy to a quick example. In this example, we have a rod of mass m. It has a length of l, so we're being very general here. The rod is hinged at one end and released from rest in the horizontal position. And I want to compute the angular velocity of the rod when it passes through the lowest point. And that's when the rod is in the vertical position in the second picture. And we get a reminder here that the moment of inertia of a rod rotated about one end is 1/3 ml squared. So this is a pure rotation problem. And we can figure out the final angular velocity by using energy conservation. And all I have to do is locate the center of mass in my initial configuration. And I'm going to go ahead and call the y coordinate there 0. We're going to put the origin at the hinge point. And that center of mass is located a distance of L over 2 from the hinge. But again, the y coordinate of the center of mass in its initial position is 0. Then we follow that center of mass until we hit the vertical position. And now my center of mass has a negative y coordinate. I have a reduction in gravitational potential energy. And that's going to be turned into the rotational kinetic energy of the rod. So we write down the formula for energy conservation. I'll start right from the beginning. E initial is equal to E final. And in my initial state, I have 0 gravitational potential energy simply because I put the origin of coordinates at that height. And I have 0 kinetic energy. So I'm just going to put a 0 on the left-hand side. And in my final state, if I look at my gravitational potential energy, I have the entire mass of the rod times G times the center of mass Y coordinate, which is negative L over 2. And I have kinetic energy in the rod, and that's going to be a 1/2 I omega squared, where I is given by this formula, 1/3 ml squared. So I'll go ahead and put that gravitational potential energy term over on the left, and I have an mgl over 2. And then on the right, I have 1/2 times the moment of inertia, which is 1/3 ml squared, multiplying omega squared, and omega is what we're after here. We can cancel a factor of m out of this, and we can cancel a factor of l out of this. And 2 times 3, that's 6. I'm going to multiply both sides by 6, and I get a 6g over here. And I'm going to divide by l on both sides, so 2l in the denominator. And again, that's all equal to omega squared. So we solve for omega, and I'm going to go ahead and cancel a factor of 2 here, giving me a 3g over L on that left-hand side. When I take the square root of that, I get that omega is the square root of 3g over L. And as just a quick check on our work, I want to look at the units of omega. So inside that square root, I have units of acceleration in the numerator, that's meters per second squared, and I have units of length in the denominator, that's meters. The meters are going to cancel, and I get the square root of 1 over seconds squared, which gives me 1 over seconds. And radians are unitless, so I can just pop the radians into the numerator, and I get units of radians per second, as I should, and we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.